Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I am your host, Jason Turner. In this episode, I'm going to pick up where I left off in that C++ 98 code restoration by moving this code from C++ 98 to C++ 11. And in the process, I am going to update my toolchain. Now, I have spared you most of the gory details of actually getting the project set up how I want it to be set up, but I'm going to start now moving that code around from the legacy folder that we had things in to our new actual project folder. So I hope you find this episode interesting, and be sure to subscribe because I will absolutely be continuing this project from 98 to 11 to 14 to 17 to 20 to 23, and we will see what changes along the way. Okay, so to keep ourselves honest here, we're going to go ahead and try compiling this project with C++ 98 mode and our current set of tools. So that's going to take some fixes to make sure that we are properly using even C++ 98 with our current tool set. So I have a mismatch here of the tools thinking that I have at least C++ 11 available to me, but I don't. I explicitly put it in C++ 98 mode. Hopefully that won't cause us too many problems. So I'm marching these things as no lint right now because I know that I'm going to come back and do some of this in C++ 11 mode when I can. Now, I could have disabled them in the config file for clang tidy, but I opted to do it this way for now because this will give me clear places to come back to and fix in a little bit. So we got it linking finally with all of our static analysis tools running, but still in C++ 98 mode. Let's see, just out of curiosity, if we can actually execute this thing. All right, that's certainly doing something, so good for us. Let's go ahead and get this checked in a moment. No, we should check our test first. Now, we kind of just want to disable magic number test, I feel like, in our unit test. That's a hard thing to decide for sure, I feel like, because it's not necessarily obvious what your best practice should be here, I feel like, but feel free to disable magic number test in your unit test. Okay, our test also now compile. Let's see if we can execute them. Test framework quit unexpectedly. I'm not sure why. It appears that all of the tests have passed, so we'll have to dig into that a little bit later. All right, we're going to commit this now. It looks about right. We moved everything around. We did some updates. Now, that is the first step to upgrading this code to C++ 11. It is going to take effort to get it integrated with a modern build system and to just get past some of the things that your old compiler allowed, but your modern compiler isn't going to allow. So I think the first thing that I personally want to do is some drastic reformatting of this code so it is all consistent with my clang format settings. Okay, now I personally would like to do this as its own commit here, just to say, yes, I did all of the reformatting as a single commit. Okay, now we can actually start doing the C++ 11 modernization that I promised in this episode. Now, C++ 11 is not going to make a lot of changes in this code, but it will make some changes, like this standard array that our linter was telling us we should use. And I can get rid of that nolint. And that also means I can use constexpr here in C++ 11 mode. And I can simplify several of these static cast expressions that I have down here as well. And we can do things like braced initialization in C++ 11. And an explicit conversion to a pointer without having to do that static cast. An option here is that I could use standard string instead. And maybe we will do that when we start making a move to, say, string view, perhaps in a little bit. That's definitely an interesting question. Now, each of these input strings should be read as null terminated strings. So I think this will be an okay way to do this. Now, the next major thing that I would like to do is make this into an enum struct or enum class, really your choice there. And that's going to be quite a bit more of a change. So my stack of operators is now going to be, well, not a stack of ints, but a stack of operators, which will clean up some other static casts and stuff that I ended up doing before. Now, I just realized that this is a potentially unsafe peak operation here. So let's go ahead and add a, well, let's do several things. Yes, let's equals default here. That's a great one. And you're going to see lots of changes from null to null pointer. Now, clang tidy modernize can automatically do this. And as we can see here, I can just click on it and it can do it as well. A downside to having done that manual change is I don't have clang tidy doing this automatically for me. And I'm going to go ahead and do some autoification along the way because auto avoids implicit conversions, and that is my main goal for using auto in these cases. Avoids the potential for an implicit conversion as well. And note, I can now actually get this proper error. I can get a notification here that close paren is not handled in the switch, and it's better able to do that in the case of having an enum struct. Now, I still have cling tidy here telling me in the GUI to mark this as no discard, but I can't because I'm in C++ 11 mode and no discard doesn't exist yet. But all of these operations should, in fact, be no discard. Now, this is a great use case for auto because I don't really want to care what the types of each of these things are. If I have my conversion warnings enabled, then the compiler will automatically tell me along the way if I have done some sort of mistake here. Okay, I think we're getting, yeah, pretty close for what we would want to do in C++ 11. In C++ 11, a constexpr member function must be const. So I think I actually could make all of these operator overloads constexpr in C++ 11 mode and the constructor. Let's see if we can make rational number constexpr in C++ 11 mode. Now, in C++ 11, your constexpr member function can only have a single return statement. It can do nothing else. So I would have to complicate this code a little bit. And this is just a pretty good aside here that we think of constexpr as perhaps a little bit more modern, but really it isn't. We can use some constexpr, if we're careful, all the way back to C++ 11. And soon in C++ 14 mode, we're going to go ahead and roll in a real unit testing framework. So I'm looking forward to doing that. But right now, the unit testing frameworks that we have simply aren't going to work in C++ 11 mode. They've all moved on from there. So this is one reason why I say in my C++ Best Practices book that you should skip C++ 11. C++ 14 is effectively a bug fix for C++ 11. Now, that means that our rational number CPP file is no longer useful. This precedence function should almost certainly be constexpr, and it is only used inside evaluator.cpp. I'm going to remove it from the header file, and I'm going to make it constexpr in here. And I'm also going to start making some of these things no except where they should be. So that's a C++ 11-ism that tells the compiler that this function can never throw an exception. I'm starting to question whether or not I should have accessors at all on this, or if I should just make my numerator and denominator actually just public and get rid of the constructor entirely. Maybe we'll revisit that in a future episode. And while I'm in here, I'm also going to rename these files to be consistent. These are, in fact, header files that only work with a C++ compiler. These are not intended for consumption by a C library or a C compiler. So to me, it makes sense to make it very clear that these are C++ header files. They are not C header files. All right, it's still telling me to make these things no discard, but I can't do that yet in C++ 11 mode. Multiple return statements and constexpr functions, so I cannot yet make this function constexpr. While I was cleaning this up, I saw an opportunity to create my own in-place function. And I can simplify a little bit of the call here for actually creating an object here of type rational number. So in place takes a set of constructor parameters and constructs the object in place. And to do that, I went ahead and used a variadic template, which was added in C++ 11 with this double ampersand here thing called a forwarding reference, is what most people call it today. And then I'm using standard forward to forward those params into the in place back function of my underlying vector. And then I am returning the element that was just constructed. And this is in line with how in place back works. And I can simplify this again by just doing return in place back, because in place back from C++ 11 already returns the newly constructed object for us. And this reminds me that I have some other no lints that I need to go check out. Yeah, here we go. I had this sync here that I wanted to do. It's syncing of the value. So if you notice, I had this no lint, and the compiler knows, clingtidy knows, that I am taking a const reference of this and then making a copy of it. And now there's this thing called the copy and move idiom, the pass by value and use standard move. I'm just going to click on that, and I'm going to let clingtidy's modernized tool do the fix for me, which you can see here. Now it takes by value. And we should probably go ahead and make a few more of these things no except where we can as well. Now, some of these things are allocating new string objects, so they're probably not going to throw an exception, but logically I can't make them no except because I don't know if creating that new string object might itself throw an exception. I can, however, mark this as no except because I know that my standard string implementation is no throw move constructible. So I know that once this function is called, I can safely move that thing without throwing an exception. I don't know if the act of calling this constructor might throw an exception. It's entirely possible that it could if I can't allocate a copy of the string object that I am consuming, but that happens before my constructor is called. That's not a problem of the constructor itself. We have a little bit more autoification we can do. I don't currently see a use case for any other algorithms or anything like that that would clean up stuff. I think we're in a pretty good place again now. I'm very much not a fan of putting trivial functions inside of the CVP file because I want to give the compiler a little bit more flexibility for being able to inline these things and know that it doesn't have to make an expensive call to a function that's in another place and simply returning a Boolean is effectively free from the compiler's perspective. It seems it was in C++ 14 that emplaceback started returning a reference to the created member. So we can clean that up later. All right, I'm going to wrap things up here. Thank you for watching this episode of C++ Weekly. As I said before, I'm absolutely going to continue doing this with a move to C++ 14, then 17, then 20, then 23, and we'll see what things in this project change along the way. Be sure to subscribe.